बिस्मिल्लाहिर्रहमानिर्रहीम, अस्सलाम वालेकुम। माय नेम इज डॉक्टर सफिया अंजुम फ्रॉम द डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ फिजिक्स, लाहौर कॉलेज फॉर वुमेन, यूनिवर्सिटी लाहौर। फ्रॉम द कोर्स ऑफ कैरेक्टराइजेशन, टुडे वी विल स्टडी द प्रोडक्शन ऑफ एक्सरेज एक्सपेरिमेंट। द एक्सरेज आर प्रोड्यूस व्हेन एवर हाई स्पीड इलेक्ट्रॉन्स collide with the metal target. Yes, when the high speed electron as a source of energy is collide on the surface of the target atoms will excite or de-excite. Due to the excitation and de-excitation of the electron inside the target material, the X-rays will be produced. Any X-ray tubes must contains the following three important instruments. One is the source of elements, the source of electrons. The source of electrons is the filament, and a high accelerating voltage. A high accelerating voltage is applied across this filament, which produce the electron, which emit the thermionic emission of the electrons. Okay, a metal target, a target which is used as a source of emission of the X-rays. When these high electrons falls on the target surface, due to the excitation and de-excitation of the electrons, the X-rays is produced. Since most of the energy of the electron is converted into heat in the target, the latter means the target is always water-cooled to prevent its melting. Because when continuously electrons, high energetic electrons fall on the surface of the target, so target may be melted and the emission of the X-rays may be not so proper. So it is very compulsory to put a water cooled assembly around the target to prevent its melting or to maintain its temperature. There are two types of the tubes used for the emission of X-rays, for the production of X-rays. One is the gas tube, other is the filament tube. In the gas tube, it is just like, it is resembled to the original X-ray tube, which is used by the Rontgen, which now obsolete. In this tube, the gas is used for the source of electrons. But now nowadays we are using the filament tube. These were invented by the Goulide in 1930. They consist of an evacuated glass tubes which insulate anode at one end and the cathode at the other end. The cathode being the tungsten filament, we are using the tungsten filament as source of electron for the emission of the electron, because tungsten is a high resistive material and its melting point is very high. So the filament and the anode, the water cooled block of the copper containing the desired target matter as a small insert at one end. So the copper, which is used as a target material for the emission of the X-rays, is placed on the anode. This is the diagram. This is the figure of the evacuated tube. Here you can see this is anode, which where the target material or the copper material is placed, and this is the filament which is at very high negative potential, and due to this high negative potential, the thermionic emission of the electrons takes place. And you can also see this is the water, cooling of water around this anode, which maintain its temperature and prevent that copper from the melting point. When the high beam energetic electrons falls on the target, the X-rays are emitted, and these X-rays are going towards these windows are made from the beryllium, which are 100% transparent for the x-rays, and these x-rays can be used for the investigation of the crystal structure. Here you can see one more thing, that is cup. This cup is at very high negative potential, and this cup is used to collimate or to focus that electrons on the target on a very sharp focus. You can see that this very high negative potential of this cup repel the electrons, because electrons are also at the negative potential, and this cup is at very high negative potential. So due to this very high negative potential of that cup, the electrons will be repelled, and on the both side, or on the from the both side, from this upper side and from this lower side, this will be repelled. And when they are repelled from the upper side and from the lower side, the electrons will be confined on a very small focal point, and the x-rays will be emitted. So we can study this detail from this slide. The high voltage transformer is connected to the filament and the other to the ground. The target being grounded by its own cooling water connection. The filament is heated by the filament current of about 3 amperes and emit electrons, which are rapidly drawn to the target by the high voltage across the tube. Because the filament is at very high negative potential, whereas the anode is very high, at very high positive potential, so electrons from the filament will accelerate towards the high positive potential where the target is fixed. Surrounding the filament, as we have seen in the figure, surrounding the filament is a small metal cup maintained at high negative voltage as the filament. It therefore repels the electrons and tend to focus them into a narrow region of the target called the focal point. From this figure we can again see this is the cup with a very high negative potential, and due to this very high negative potential, these electrons will be focused on a very small focal point and target, and fall on the surface of the target for the emission of x-rays. X-rays are emitted from the focal point is all in all direction and escape from the tube through two or more windows in the tube housing, and these windows must be vacuum tight and highly transparent to the x-rays. They are usually made of beryllium, as we have seen in this figure. There are two windows, or this window and this window. When the x-rays are generated from the target material, they are they can be transmitted from these tubes by this beryllium window, because this window is 100% transparent for the x-rays. Now we are talking about the source. Which source we can use, DC source or AC source, for the emission of electrons? One might think that an x-ray tubes would operate only from a DC source, since the electrons flow in one direction, because we are always seeing that the electrons are flowing in one direction, not in the two direction. So the DC, which is directional oriented voltage, maybe there is no fluctuation in DC, so we can easily use for the generation of electrons. So but it is very expensive. The DC source is very expensive, and maintenance is also very expensive. So it is not preferred to use the DC source in the X-ray tube. It is usually possible to operate a tube from an AC source, such as transformer. Because of the rectifying properties of the tube itself, tube has a rectifying properties, and it only works in one cycle, maybe in negative or maybe in positive. When we are talking about the negative electrons, we are talking about the electrons, it will work in a negative half cycle, and in positive half cycle there will be no emission of the electrons. So the access of the transformer or the AC source is very easy, and it is very cheap. That's why we prefer to use the transformer. In this, the current exists during the half cycle in which the filament is negative with respect to target. During the positive half cycle, the filament is positive, but no electrons can flow since only the filament is hot through to emit the electrons. In this case, when the filament is positive, the emission of electron is stopped from the filament, but we know that the filament is heated sufficiently. When it is heated, it has a capability to emit the thermionic emission of the electrons. So during negative half cycle, we can obtain the electron from the filament directly, or we can also obtain the electrons from the positive half cycle due to the hotness of the filament, not due to the positive half cycle. In this positive half cycle, only the heat is responsible for the emission of the electron. The voltage applied to the tube is controlled by the autotransformer, which is controlled the voltage applied to the primary of the high voltage transformer. This can be seen from this figure. This is the autotransformer, and this autotransformer is connected with the primary coil of the very high voltage transformer. And here we can see there is a voltmeter, and voltmeter is used to measure the voltage of the high voltage transformer to the tube. And here is the milliammeter, which is used to measure the current. And this current is controlled by the filament rheostat. And filament rheostat, you can see here, we are using the step down transformer because a very low voltage, about 5 volt to 10 volt, is used to apply across this filament. And this rheostat is used to control the voltage and the current across this filament. By changing the resistance of this rheostat, if the resistance is high, the current is low. If the resistance is low, then the current is high. So we can control the current of this filament. So this explanation is given in this slide. The voltage applied to the tube is controlled by the autotransformer, which controls the voltage applied to the primary of the high voltage transformer. And the voltmeter shown in this measure the input voltage, but may be calibrated if desired to read the output voltage applied to the tube. The milliammeter measures the tube current, that is the flow of the current from the filament to the target, because the electrons is going to flow from the cathode to the anode. This current is normally of the order of 10 to 25 milliampere and is controlled by the filament rheostat, as I have shown you in this figure, that this rheostat is used to control the current. Now, the rheostat controls the output voltage of the filament transformer by controlling the resistance of the rheostat, and this rheostat controlling the voltage, and this voltage determine many factors. This voltage determine the filament current, the temperature of the filament, and the number of electrons it can be emitted per second. The filament transformer is a low voltage step down transformer. It is only applied 5 volt to the filament. It is itself at a high negative voltage relative to the ground and must be well insulated. Now we can see that the voltage are very important, because if the voltage are high, then the current flowing through the filament is high and the temperature is also high. If the voltage is high, then the number of emission of the electron, number of electrons which are emitted from the filament per second is high, and the filament transformer is a low voltage step down transformer, as we have seen in the figure that this is the step down transformer. So there are different kinds of the filament tubes, sealed off tube and the demountable tube. Sealed off tube is expensive tubes because it is evacuated and sealed off at laboratory. It is far easy to operate. No high vacuum pump is needed. However, it is expensive. Why it is expensive? Because the life of the tube is determined by the life of the filament. If the filament is out of order, then the tube will be wasted, or we cannot use that tube again, and we cannot repair that tube because it is sealed off tube. And the demountable tubes, they are used nowadays for the special purposes. Both target and the filament are accessible for the replacement. Both target and filament are acceptable for this. Both targets and filaments are accessible for the filament, and we can change the filament. If the filament is out of order, we can change the filament. If the target, if we want to change the target, usually we are using the target copper for the emission of X-rays. If we want to use the cobalt, we want to use another metal for the emission of X-rays, so we can change the X-rays as we can change the target as well. Burn out filament can be replaced and the target can be interchanged according to our will. They must be pumped continuously during the operation. Both diffusion and mechanical pump are necessary to obtain the high vacuum. So in the presence of the high vacuum, we can change the filament, and we can change the target as well. Demountable tube is durable and it is very easy to use. Now the second problem is the rotating anode tubes. Since X-rays tube is less than 1% efficient in the production of X-rays, and the intensities of the diffracting X-ray beams are extremely low. These intensities, we want to obtain a high intensity of diffracted X-ray beam. So how we can obtain the high intensity X-ray beam, and we want to improve the efficiency of the production of X-rays? It may, when the intensity of the X-rays are very low, it requires as much as several hours exposure to the photographic film in order to detect them at all. So if we spend a lot of time in the detection of X-rays, how we can perform the experiment, how we can perform the investigation of the crystal structure? So it become a little bit difficult. First of all, we will improve the intensity of X-rays. The constant efforts are being made to increase the intensity of X-rays. One solution to this problem is to the rotating anode. The rotating anode means the target pasted on the anode is also rotating. Basically, we want to rotate the target material. Whenever the electrons, the beam of the electrons fall on the surface of the target, if the target is not rotated, what will happen? The surface of the target materials is heated, and the molten place will become, and the emission of the X-rays will be difficult from that surface. So we want to rotate that target material for the exposure of the electron. That electrons will found the new surface or the fresh surface of the target each time, and they can emit the electrons and they can generate the X-rays very well, high intensity X-rays. So the one solution is to for this problem is the rotating anode tube, in which the rotation of the anode continuously bring the fresh target metal into the focal spot area. and so allows a greater power input without excess heating of anode. So in this case, when the anode is or the target is rotated, so every time the fresh surface will come, and the temperature of the target material will be controlled due to the rotation, and it prevents its melting. Such tubes can operate at a power level 5 to 10 times higher than the fixed focus tube. Now another tube, that is the micro focus tube, some diffraction method requires extremely fine X-ray beam. So we can focus that X-ray beam by applying the high negative potential around that cup. That cup, which is at very high negative potential as compared to the electron, this will repel the electron in a very sharp or in a very small focal point. So such beams are mostly efficient to produce by the special demountable X-ray tube called the microfocus tube, in which special attention is paid to achieve a very small focal point. The design problem, the fine focusing of the electron beam, is similar to that of electron microscope or X-ray microscope. One focusing method is electrostatic and consists simply in maintaining the focusing cup around the filament at a potential of a few hundred volts more negative than the filament. So it means if we are going to apply a very high negative potential around the filament, so this negative potential will repel the electron to confine it in a very small focal point. Now next is the pulse tube. If the tube, pulse tubes mean it will give the electron, it will give the X-rays in a pulse, and then after that pulse there is a delay, then again pulse, then there is a delay. It's mean during that delay the tube can maintain its temperature, so there is no need to the chiller or the water cooling. If the tube is operated for only a small fraction of the second, a pulse of the X-rays can be obtained at a very high power level without any cooling. This can be done by slowly charging a bank of capacitors and then abruptly discharging them across the special X-ray tube. Yes, a bank of capacitor is needed for this pulse tube because we need a pulse. When a whole bank of the capacitors allowed to discharge, they are allowed abruptly. So this instantaneous behavior will give the pulse X-rays. In this way, an X-ray pulse lasting about 30 nanoseconds, this duration is very small, at a peak voltage of 300 kilovolt and a peak current of 5000 ampere has been produced. A large or very huge amount of X-rays and very high intensity of X-rays can be produced in pulse tube. Next is the miniature tube. If increased attention is given during the design of an X-ray tube, we need focusing of an electron beam, shape and placement of the target, intensity of the beam from the tube can be made about as large as that from a conventional. Here we can see that the focusing of electron is very important. Shape and placement of the target is also very important because it is a miniature tube. This miniature tube is very small, but here we can see that the intensity of the beam extracted from this miniature tube is just like the same as the big tube or the conventional tube. So these parameters are very important, but with the power input of 1/10 or less. As a result, water cooling is not needed. Air cooling is sufficient because it is a very small, and 1/10 of the power is used. Power is very less, so there is no need to cool it with water. This feature is important for the portable operators because this is a miniature tube and it can be portable from one place to another place for the analysis of the material. After the production of X-rays, the detection of X-ray is very important. The principal means used to detect the X-ray beams are, what are the means? One is the fluorescence screen, the photographic film, and a counter. By placing the fluorescence screen in front of the X-ray, by the emission of this fluorescence, we can judge that yes, these are the X-rays. And by the application of the photographic film, we can also measure the blackening of the photographic film. If the blackening of the photographic film is very high, then we can judge that the intensity of the X-rays are high. If the blackening of the photographic film is very low, then it means the intensity of X-ray is low. And the third one is the counter. Counter is used to count the number of X-rays which are emitted from the X-ray tube. So from these principal means we can detect the X-rays. This is all about the how we can produce the X-rays from the X-ray tubes and how we can obtain the high intensity X-rays, how we can control the target material or the rotation of the target to achieve the high intensity X-rays. And in the last, there are many types of the X-ray tubes, pulse tube, miniature tube. These are portable and having a very high X-rays. At the end, the detection of the X-rays, which include the fluorescence screen, photographic film, and the counter. Thank you very much for your attention.